Grueling battle, it's down to two at the US Amateur Championship. One of the finalists is Italian Edoardo Molinari, aiming to be the first European winner of this prestigious title for 94 years.
Clutch putt by Molinari.
He's asking for it to go. The line's good. Oh, he answers.
Did he ever.
Beauty.
He takes on American Dillon Dougherty, who produced two miracle shots to claim his place.
He's picking up speed. Perfect.
And there's his dad coming off the hill.
He's electing to go high, trying to carry this ball onto the green and get off the flag. It's off the flag stick. Man, oh man.
Europe versus America, Molinari against Dougherty for the right to be crowned U.S. amateur champion. We saw some pretty good stuff in the semi-finals, and we're hoping the final will live up to that. There's no doubt that Dillon Dougherty will get most of the support as the American, but Edoardo Molinari is nicknamed the engineer for the calm, methodical way he goes about things, and the young Italian has a fighting chance if he can stick to his game plan. Brian Barnes is with us again. Brian, what's the approach in a 36-hole match play final? Is it patience, or is it get out, go quick, go hard at it, and get as many up as you can?
Medal.
Right.
You just play the golf course. Until your opponent gets into a position where maybe he's knocked it into water, knocked it out of bounds, then maybe you might change your game plan. But really, once again, you've got to go out there and play your own game.
You've played, you know, Ryder Cups on American soil and stuff. How difficult is it for Molinari to go there when all the support will be for Dillon Dougherty? How much of a factor will that be?
Hopefully it'll sort of get him going. You know, and make him more determined. But really, the type of golf course that he's playing there might be a little more normal in Italy, in actual fact, than it is in America, because it seems very much more of a seaside type golf course.
Mm-hmm.
It's small greens, very tight targets, very tight fairways. And the way that he hits the ball, he seems to be very accurate off the tee and have a good mental attitude as far as his, you know, the mind is concerned. But the most important thing both these guys must do is go out there and play their own game. And if one gets ahead, because it's 36 holes, if one gets too far ahead, 3, 4, 5 up, in the first round, mm-hmm. there's nothing to panic about. You've still got a long way to go.
OK, we look forward to the final then. Let's just remind you how these guys got through to face each other. Dougherty, in the end, winning it at the final hole against J.C. Deacon. Molinari slightly more comfortable, although he was 4 or 5 up at one stage against Eden. And it was a good win in the end. He held his nerve. So our final is Dillon Dougherty of the United States against Edoardo Molinari of Italy. If you haven't seen Merion before, you're in for a real treat. It's an absolute cracker. Staged a couple of US Opens in the past. We're going to get into the coverage of this final of the US Amateur Championship with NBC Television.
And through 26 holes after the morning 18 today, where Dillon Dougherty had a 3-up lead on Edoardo Molinari, it is gone. And in fact, Molinari has taken the 1-up lead in this match as they are now on the long par 3 ninth, 194 yards. Molinari with 4 wins so far. I'm joined by Gary Koch, Roger Maltby out on the golf course. It has been some turnaround for this 24-year-old Italian, Gary.
Well, it has been, and started off exactly the way you would hope to in the afternoon round if you were behind. Birdies on the first two holes to cut into the lead, and certainly playing some beautiful golf. This par three, downhill, but a tough hole location today, right on the front portion of the green. There's a little pond right in front of the green, which certainly can come into play.
Ball starts right of the hole, drawing just right of the flag.
Very wise shot, slightly behind the hole location.
Both these players participating in their very first U.S. Amateur Championship, and it's been an emotional roller coaster for Dillon. You saw his father, Dan, there on the bag less than a month after Dan's father, Dillon's grandfather, passed away following a tragic golf cart accident that occurred the day before Father's Day. Shortly after that, Dillon qualified for this U.S. Amateur and said, Dad, I want you on the bag. You're going to be with me all week long. And here he is in the finals.
Well, you have to, after having watched some of the things that have occurred for Dillon Dougherty to get to the finals, you have to wonder if perhaps fate has not played a hand in it. All right, with a 5-iron, Roger.
Whole place is substantially downhill, so it doesn't play all of it. It's 195 yards, and this just left of the flagstick.
Beautiful shot by Dillon. Well, there was a morning 18. Both Dillon Dougherty and Edoardo Molinari were here early in the morning getting ready for it. And this was Dillon Dougherty's start at the very first hole. The short par 4 first rolls it in to quickly take the one-up lead. And this was kind of the story for Molinari in the early going. One down for par to win the hole at 3. Didn't hit some bad putts, Gary, but just the ball was catching the edge and not going in for him.
Well, that can happen on these extremely quick greens with the cups cut very sharply. If the ball doesn't go in the center of the hole, oftentimes it won't go in.
Molinari squared it up again after that bogey miss at 5 and then the par miss at 9 after he had squared it up. He goes one down again there, and then on the 303 par 4 tenth, short par 4 tenth. This was Dougherty's second from the rough, and he would birdie that to take a 2-up lead. And then at 15 up the hill on the par 4, the second shot here for Dougherty.
Now this absolutely perfectly played into the slope about 8 yards, 10 yards behind the hole. Green's much softer today after the rain this morning.
This looked like an eagle too for a moment.
It did look like it may go in.
So after watching Dougherty shot, Molinari from the right rough steps in, and you just don't know how it's going to come out of here.
Well, this a much more difficult shot up the hill. Again, a guess. How quickly will the ball come out of the rough? He guesses just right.
They conceded birdies for both of them there. Good, good. So it was Dougherty still with a 2-up lead. He won the 17th with a par to build a 3-up lead after the morning 18, and then in the afternoon 18, this was the first hole. Dougherty may have gotten the birdie this morning, but Molinari wasted no time.
Beautiful bladed wedge shot from the fringe.
And then at the par 5 second, the 20th hole, a birdie start for Molinari. And all of a sudden, he was just one down. And then at the 5th, both players in trouble at the 504-yard par 4, so a long third shot here for Molinari to try to save par.
He utilizes the slope in the green beautifully, spins the ball back underneath the hole. He would make that putt for par to win the hole.
And then all square here for birdie at the 7th. This would be his first lead of the entire championship day here. So didn't have a single lead in the morning 18 and took his first lead there with that putt there at the 7th. So that is the way they stand right now. One up for Molinari, trying to put his name on the Havemeyer Trophy. And what a journey it has been. Got in after the 2 days of stroke play, holed out a bunker shot from 40 feet for birdie on his final hole of stroke play qualifying to get in. It happened here at Merion. So he got into a 19 for 17 playoff. And then the first round of match play made a 15-footer on 18 to extend his match with Emilio Dominguez of Argentina, won on the 20th hole. In the second round against Walker Cover, Matt Every, 12-footer for par to win the 18th, then won the match on the first extra hole, made an 8-footer for par, while Every missed from 3 feet. So this has been some incredible journey for Molinari, who again had to hole out a bunker shot just to get into the playoff, to get into the match play, which began on Wednesday. What a week it's been, coming to a close here. Molinari for birdie now at 9.
Well, quick putt down the hill should turn left toward the front of the green. And a beauty!
Molinari 4-under on this afternoon 18. So the first 9 and 32 for him. Hats off to him. And here is Dillon Dougherty's road to this final. little higher seeding there, 71 and 72 after the 2 days at Philadelphia Country Club and Merion. And some pretty good victories here, especially over Gary Wolstenholme, the all-time leading point getter for Great Britain and Ireland's Walker Cup team, 4-1. And they beat Dane Burkhardt, who had taken out a couple of heavyweights here, and John Holmes and James Lepp, the reigning NCAA champion. And then the magical semifinal win over J.C. Deacon, the fifth-year senior out of UNLV, when Dougherty chipped in at 17 and then went on to 18, bouncing it off the stick. Special stuff. We'll show you that in a moment. But that was some finish for him to make it into this 36-hole final.
Well, it was some unbelievable stuff. And now he needs some more unbelievable stuff right here. Needs to make this downhill birdie putt, or we'll be two down as he goes to the 28th hole.
And again, he had the 3-up lead after the morning 18.
Nope, that's high.
And Molinari really has Dougherty on the run. With that win, he's now won 5 of the last 9 holes and has turned around that 3-down deficit into a 2-up lead for himself. Happy to have you with us here at Merion. And Gary, these players already know full well that they are on their way to the U.S. Open, on their way to the Masters as a result of getting into this 36-hole final. But now it's trophy day and a chance to etch your name on the Havemeyer Trophy with the likes of Bobby Jones, who completed the Grand Slam here at Merion back in 1930, Arnold Palmer, Jack Nicklaus. Pretty heady stuff again.
Well, it is. No question about it. It is the premier golf event in amateur golf. Certainly both of these guys, I'm sure, have dreamed about this day, about the potential and the chance to win this great championship. You know, I'm impressed with the play. I really am. And I think one of the reasons why the play is better today than it was yesterday is because those berths in the U.S. Open and the Masters have already been determined. So a little of the pressure is off from that standpoint. But you have to really hand it to Edoardo Molinari to shoot 4 under par on the front 9 going out in the afternoon match. That is heady and very impressive stuff. I mean, you got to remember the best 18-hole medal play score in the qualifier in the stroke play here at Merion was a 1 under par 69, and only 5 players were able to accomplish that. So Molinari playing extremely well.
All right. Well, we mentioned the emotional week it has been for the Doughertys, the passing of the grandfather less than a month ago. This was the finish yesterday from high on the hill. He was 1 down to J.C. Deacon. And in this, the 3rd shot on this par 4, takes 1 hop, hits the stick, goes down, and that produced the 1-up win for Dillon Dougherty over J.C. Deacon. So a magical finish at 17 and 18, and that is how the Doughertys, father and son, got a date with Edoardo Molinari in the championship match. They're 2 down at the moment through 27.
U.S. Amateur was my confidence builder, my jump from amateur to pro, my ability to know that I needed to go to the next level, plus the fact that it was great championships to win.
A launch for Jack, 2-time champion in 59 and 61. Next hole here, Gary, at Merion, the short par 4 10th.
Just 303 yards, plays slightly uphill, gives the players a lot of options. They can play short to this area right here at about 235 to 255, or if you want to take a gamble, take a driver, try to turn it around the trees, up the hill, and leave a very easy little pitch shot. Hole location today over in the middle left portion of the green, and this is certainly a good birdie opportunity if you can put the ball in the fairway.
Here is Molinari with that 2-up lead on the strength of the 4 birdies in the first 9 here.
Well, going with the 3 metal club. And by the applause, you would think that is good. And it is.
And they drill down on top of that hill.
Well, next Sunday, we're going to be back on course out at Pebble Beach for the Walmart first tee open at Pebble Beach. Watch as the stars of tomorrow teed up with the legends of the past, including Tom Watson, Hale Irwin, Gary Player. It's really a neat event, and it's next Sunday at 3 o'clock Eastern Time, noon Pacific, on NBC.
Had a chance to play in that last year, Dan, and I can tell you it is a very special event for the Champions Tour players and for the juniors who are competing.
Yeah, a kid that's given an opportunity the play of the game and then walk shoulder to shoulder with the stars.
Well, Dougherty doesn't like that one, but I think it's going to be okay. Came out of it a little bit, but
well back,
it will be safely in the fairway.
Short par 410 at the 105th U.S. Amateur. Dillon Dougherty finds himself two down through 27 in this 36-hole final. Championship match continues from Ardmore, Pennsylvania in a moment.
We'll look back over the U.S. Amateur, over the Buick Championship, what happened in Munich, and look ahead to the week's events. All the rest of the stuff, as usual, of course, in World of Golf, coming up this Wednesday, 5 o'clock on Sky Sports Extra or 7 o'clock on Sky Sports 3. If you have any golf inquiries or questions, you can email the show on worldofgolf@skysports.com. That's coming up this Wednesday. And in the meantime, time for us to get back to Merion and rejoin the final of the U.S. Amateur.
Dillon Dougherty now two down to Edoardo Molinari as they get ready for the second shots to the par 4 10th.
89 yards to the hole, and by virtue of being this far back, has to control his spin. Really, he doesn't spin it too much.
Yeah, going to have to throw the ball back behind the hole and hope it comes back. Well, it does.
Just below it, hit a fine shot in. There's Morning 18 to birdie it and grab a two-up lead for Molinari. He's in need of one right now. Molinari way up there, a lot further up.
Only 54 yards to the hole, so that won't be as big a problem for him, certainly. I don't believe he'll be able to carry it behind the hole and get it to spin back from this distance. I think he's going to have to land it short of the hole and try to skip it back to the hole.
Roger, hole placed just over a slight little ridge in the green there, two or three paces over. The idea, you think, landed just short of that and try to skip it up over the little ridge?
Well, that would be the way I would go about trying to play this shot, but maybe if he can get the ball up in the air with some spin on it and land it just on top, he might be able to get the ball to stay close.
Folks, let's wait a second. Let's let him home, please.
Oh, he did get it to come back. What a shot.
Two excellent shots into the hole there at the 10th by Molinari and Dougherty. Just a reminder, we have our coverage of the US Open Championship, the tennis, that is, the final Grand Slam of the year, getting underway Monday from 4 o'clock on Sky Sports 2 from Flushing Meadows. And we'll be covering that through, of course, the next couple of weeks, right to the finals. That's coming up. In the meantime, let's get back to Merion.
Well, the rest of the family and many family and friends have come in following Dillon's progress this year. There is Dan. His brother Neil took the red eye in, so all four kids of the late Bill Dougherty are here watching Dillon try to put this away. Bill, a very accomplished golfer, played in the French Amateur Championship, British Amateur Champion, club champion at his club in Woodland, California, and there is the hat that Dan has been wearing with the words Papa on the right side. Molinari has made his putt. And so back for the half.
Big putt there, Dan. Big putt to try to stifle the momentum a little.
Dougherty's play on. Two down to Molinari from Italy in the championship match of the 105th U.S. Amateur. Back here in the 2005 U.S. Amateur Championship, the East Course at Merion, 68-46 in yardage, the shortest course for this championship since Pebble Beach in 1999. The course is playing more than 300 yards longer than it did in the last open stage here, Gary, in 1981. And a beautiful look at that par 4, 11th with Cobbs Creek ringing around the right side of the green. And 11, of course, has even more special significance in what happened here 75 years ago as we celebrate the 75th anniversary of Bobby Jones's Grand Slam win, the U.S. Amateur title here, putting that away back in 1930. And another look from high above, the 367-yard hole.
Par 4 slightly dog-legging to the left. The players drive over a ridge right here where the arrows indicate going down. They try to place the ball in this area, some 255 yards off the tee. They'll play a short iron to a very small green. And yes, the X is there. You don't want to go right or short. Creek is right there in play. Hole today is located over on the right-hand side of the green. So That creek certainly in play.
Bobby Jones put away Gene Holmans in the final September 27th, 1938 and 7. And that was his last competitive match. It ended right here at this hole where Molinari and Dougherty are playing, and right next to each other there getting ready for their seconds, Raj.
Both played irons from the tee beautifully. As you say, their ball only a yard apart. Molinari here first to play. 126 we have for him to the hole. He has really taken control of this match, starting at number 7. He had Dougherty inside of him for birdie there. He made the putt first, won that hole, made a great up and ended 8. To have that hole, when it looked like he might lose that, was in 2 bunkers in that hole. 9, he made a bomb before Dougherty had a makeable birdie putt, who missed. He won that hole. Really been something to watch. This ball, well left of the hole at the center of the green. Got to respect that water right, Gary.
Well, you certainly do, especially with a 2-up lead. Now, for Dillon Dougherty, perhaps a different story. Roger, I would think, needs to be a little bit more aggressive.
Well, I thought that putt he made at the last hole was really a very important putt for him. You can see after Molinari made his birdie putt at the 9th, Dillon was shaking his head as though he was stunned, as though he'd been hit by a punch. That's now 125, and I agree with you. He needs to take the ball out the hole, try to give himself a makeable birdie putt here. This ball pulled well left.
Not too bad.
Not what he was looking for, though, Dan.
Nope.
Yep. Well, Edoardo Molinari is a long way away from his hometown in Torino, Italy, site of the upcoming Winter Olympics. And earlier, Jimmy Roberts sat down with a 24-year-old playing in his first U.S. amateur.
So, Edoardo, how big a deal was the U.S. amateur in Italy before this week?
I'm not sure whether it was a very big deal or not, because almost no one had ever come over to play it. So it was kind of unknown and that stuff. But I think from next week on, many people will be talking about the USAM, and probably in the next few years, a few others Italian will come over to play it.
You have a younger brother. He's 2 years younger than you, I understand. And he is a rookie on the European Tour. It's kind of unusual for the younger brother, you know, to be the one who is playing professional golf first. Does the fact that he's playing on tour and playing well, is that something that motivates you or drives you?
It motivates me, yeah, because, I mean, up to last year, we had been playing a lot of golf together. And then all of a sudden, he was on the European Tour and was still playing amateur events. So this year, I just wanted to give it my best shot at it. And I mean, I had a very good season so far because I played the Open and been playing well in this one. So I'm very, very pleased about it. And he's pleased as well, of course.
What about Augusta National? I presume you've seen it on television, eh?
Yeah, seen a lot of times on television. I think the first time I saw it was when Faldo won it against Norman. I can't remember the year.
96.
Yeah, and I have been playing a lot on the laptop computer, on a video game. So I know the yardages, I know the breaks, I know the course very well, I think.
Well, he might want to get himself a video of winged foot side of the U.S. Open next year so he can learn the yardages and the breaks over there as well.
Well, I guess he'll find out just how accurate the video game is, too, when he gets to Augusta.
He said he was going to try this championship one time before turning professional. So he flew over from Italy just to qualify last month. After he made it, he went back home, then returned here for the championship, and here he is in the final.
Putt coming across the green should move toward the water as it gets near the hole, and another beautiful looking putt.
Molinari drains another one. Yeah. six birdies that Molinari has thrown Dougherty's direction in the afternoon. And three in a row now for Molinari. Four in the last five holes. What a streak. And all you can do after you see that is shake your head.
Man, oh man.
So Dougherty with that late finishing magic yesterday, and Molinari giving it to him back today. Champions who've trailed after the first 18 holes since the finals in 73. Well, only seven have come back, but Ryan Moore did it last year at Wingfoot, overcoming Luke List, and of course Tiger Woods five down to Steve Scott at Pumpkin Ridge when he put away his third consecutive U.S. Amateur title. So Molinari in pretty good company if he's if he can hang on.
Well, Gary, wouldn't you think right now he has to fight off feeling sorry for himself? I was kind of shaking my head like, I can't believe this is happening to me, but you really don't have time for that right now, do you?
No, I would agree with that 100%. Roger, you've got to get your mind right on what you need to do, and that's stand up here, pick out the line, concentrate on making a good stroke.
So now it is a three-up lead. Again, Molinari was three down after the first 18. He has been on a tear. Well, next weekend, it's crunch time in another sport. In prime time, as NASCAR goes west for the Nextel Cup Racing from California, presented by McDonald's. There's only a couple of events left in the race for the chase, so every point is crucial. It's Nextel Cup Racing from California next Sunday at 7 Eastern, and Busch Series Racing from California next Saturday at 8:30 Eastern time. Making their way to the par 4 12th, 403-yard hole.
And another beautiful par 4, a dogleg right. Tee shot comes out of this chute of trees. Players will be aiming at this far bunker you see, the far one to the right. Ideally drive the ball somewhere in this range, 260 to 285. Fairway slopes from left to right, so ball will be below their feet as they play their second shot to a very elevated and sloping green. The bunker there on the right is very deep. You don't want to be there. Hole location, well, it's over there by that bunker, as you would expect. And this, Dan, one of the more severely sloped greens here at Merion. In fact, is being maintained a little differently than some of the other ones. Not cut quite as close, trying to keep the speed the same as the other greens, but we saw Dillon Dougherty earlier this morning almost putt the ball off the green here from behind the hole.
You talked about how this is not too surprising to see Molinari play this well, and the conversation with Jimmy Roberts. Yes, he has a younger brother who's a rookie on the European Tour, but Molinari himself was tied for 15th after the halfway mark at this year's British Open at St. Andrews. He ended up finishing 60th in that championship.
There we see the very meticulous routine that he goes through, known as the engineer on the golf course by those who play with him back at home. Says he is very particular about what he does, plays the percentages, tries not to take any chances.
He's also played in 10 European Tour events, Gary, and has made the cut three times in those.
Well, beautiful setup position here as we take a look at the swing. Big wide shoulder turn away now. A little bit of a lag and a drop as the club loops down to the inside, almost a little bit reminiscent of Sergio Garcia. Big wide finish, full extension, beautiful balance.
And you can see that beard. He is not going to shave, doesn't shave during competition. He says after it's over, he'll go back to the blade. It's been a long week, so the beard is long. Look at Dougherty's line.
Well, has not struck the ball as well as Molinari. Very different golf swing, much more arms oriented. Club gets back past parallel, creates the speed with the arm swing coming forward, and let's take a look at just what we're talking about here. Another beautiful setup position. Nice wide stance, big full shoulder turn, but watch how the arms kind of move a little farther than the shoulders do, and the club gets back past parallel. Very reminiscent of a Tom Watson. Big strong move though up onto the left side going forward. And there's that little drag with the right foot. He moves that weight so much forward so fast.
Edoardo Molinari has turned this Championship Sunday around in his favor. The latest birdie coming at the scenic 11th, where Bobby Jones closed it out for the Grand Slam win 75 years ago. Can Molinari put his name also on that Havemeyer Trophy and become the first Italian to do it?
The U.S. Amateur is the most memorable tournament to me because of a couple of reasons. I wanted at Cherry Hills, where Arnold Palmer won the 1960 U.S. Open, and because of the history of the event of the U.S. Amateur Championship, with Bobby Jones being such a great champion for it, and for the event going on for nearly 100 years.
Mickelson, the winner back in 90 at Cherry Hills, and Denver 6 months later, he won in Tucson while still being an amateur.
Good look at that hole location, placed very close to that extremely deep bunker that guards the front right portion of the green. Looks like Dougherty will be first to play, Roger.
He will, 139 yards. Side hill lie here, hole cut on the right side of the green. Virtually the same kind of stance that Bill Molinari have as well.
Well, both players in their first U.S. amateurs here, and other players to win in their first attempt. It's been done as recently as Nick Flanagan. Remember him at Oakmont just a couple of years ago. Jeff Quinney at Baltusrol, Matt Kuchar, and on down the list.
Chris Patton right here in 1989 at Merion.
Yep. Dillon Dougherty's grandfather, such a huge influence on his game. He used to tag along to Palm Springs when he was just a kid. His late grandfather used to go out there and belong to a club called Hideaway Golf Club in Palm Springs. And that is the hat on Dan, Dillon's dad. It says Hideaway on the front edge of that. And that was his father's hat. He's worn it all week. He's had a picture inside of his father in there as well. And it's been Dan who's had the toughest time dealing with the tragedy that happened the day before Father's Day.
All right, ideally take the ball a little left of the hole, move it a little left to right.
Stay there.
This ball moving just a little right of the hole.
Sit down. Sit down.
Well, even though it'll back up off the green, it is a good position to play from because it's right back up the hill.
That's almost virtually the same putt he had this morning, isn't it? From or his second putt when he putted it nearly off the green.
Very close, Roger, yes.
Well, Molinari not here by himself. He also has his father, Paolo, here with him this week. Paolo, a member at Torino Golf Club in Italy, and that is where Edoardo began playing his golf with his brother. His mom, Michaela, is back home in Italy, trying to follow these matches on the internet.
Just now from 130 yards. Oh, that's a good looking shot. This is right at the flagstick.
Oh, this should come right back toward the hole.
How about this round going for Molinari? 6 under to this point in the afternoon as that one drifts back a little bit.
First cut.
But the competitive course record at Merion, 6 under. 64, Lee Mackey in the 1950 U.S. Open in the first round. Ben Crenshaw in the last open played here in 81 in the third round. Now, since this is match play, it wouldn't officially count, but it's something
well,
to maybe keep an eye on.
Well, it's still spectacular play, no question about it. And obviously, the softer conditions contributing to the good play of these players in this final.
Well, the morning 18 featured some fine shot making and some good sportsmanship as well. This was Molinari from a difficult stance there, his second from the bunker at 14. And after he drilled that nice one on the right side of the wicker basket flag, he got an applause from his opponent, Dillon Dougherty. And at 15, a reversal of roles of sort. Dougherty hits one tight. This is the one we saw a little bit earlier, which uses the slope. Looked like for a moment it might drop in for the eagle too. And after that, it was Molinari saying to Dougherty, good shot, thumbs up. And then at the ninth, this was Molinari's birdie. Had to take the two up lead, and Dougherty says, nice going, pal. It's been that way throughout this Sunday championship match here.
Well, it certainly has. And to me, too, Dan, that's another nice aspect of match play. There's a more personal aspect when you're going head to head against someone. If you're playing in a stroke play tournament, yes, you're playing with a fellow competitor, but you're really trying to play the golf course. You're trying to shoot the lowest score. Here it is a little bit more personal.
Well, it's one of the great traditions here at Merion, Gary, the wicker baskets that sit atop the flagsticks here on the East Course. The idea of course designer Hugh Wilson, believed to have brought the idea back from his travels in Great Britain, and all the wicker baskets today in the exact same hole location as they were in the morning 18. And David Fay, you can give us the reason why that's the case.
Well, counting practice rounds, we've cut the holes in nine different spots in each of the greens in 9 days, and there are only so many good hole locations. But also, even if you may have a few more, you don't want to get too close to unhealed old hole plugs. And plus, for both of these players, neither one has an advantage over the other. As you said, Danny, they played all 18 this morning.
Those baskets, by the way, painted dark red on the front nine, and here on the back nine, a reddish orange.
And of course, when the wind blows, which it's really not today, it's just one of those things that makes it that much more difficult to play, Merion, because when you look up to a green, you can't tell what the wind's doing necessarily, because there's no flag blowing on top of the flagstick.
Although it's a bit of a mystery exactly where Wilson exactly got the idea exactly from.
Yeah, there's several clubs over in England and Scotland, but none seem to really claim that they were the first to have them.
Part of the Merion mystique. Dougherty off to the right there.
Well, the way this guy's going with the putter, Gary, I guess you really wouldn't bet against him here, would you?
No, I don't see how you could, Roger. The two putts that he's just made in the previous two holes were, two out of the last three, 9 and 11, pretty impressive.
I wouldn't believe there could be a lot of break in this putt, pretty much up the fall line of the green. Might want to go a little left.
Well, Molinari getting to this point has proved to be pretty popular back in Italy. He says he's getting lots of messages on his cell phone, Gary, that he does not recognize the numbers of where they came from.
Yeah.
So he's making some noise back in Italy, in Torino, that's for sure.
Said he's going to be very busy when he returns next week, trying to return all those calls. Slow putt here. No, it's never quite got it going. Just coming out of this fringe area, and oftentimes the ball will get jumping just a little bit, and that's exactly what that one did. And usually, Dan, when the ball gets in the air like that, it's going to come up short. Roger, not an easy little putt here left for Dougherty.
No, it's not. It's got a little movement to the right in it, so you know, these are the kinds of putts that you have to hit so precisely, easy to hit it a little too hard and hit it through the break, or a little too easy and watch it fall underneath.
Well, he's got a beautiful pre-putt routine, very similar to that of Brad Faxon, noted great putter on the PGA Tour. You'll see him looking at the target, just lets the putter move back and forth, doesn't make a practice stroke and then stop and start all over again. Take a quick look and let it go.
Dougherty stays three down to Molinari. With six holes left, it might take a little more magic for Team Dougherty to try to pull this off as they go to the quaint little par 3 13th across the road.
Well, it is a beautiful little par 3, just 120 yards. And the first thing that jumps out at you, this huge bunker that guards the front of the green. very deep. Do not want to go there. Big lip on this bunker hides most of the putting surface from the tee. Hole today is cut just some 5 paces over the bunker. This is the side angle. Dan, very much of a punch bowl kind of green. Everything kind of funnels in toward the center of the putting surface. Now, earlier in the week, these front hole locations here were very difficult, but now with the greens much softer, a chance with a pitching wedge to maybe throw the ball behind the hole a little bit and have it come back. So look for perhaps a good tee shot here and a birdie opportunity from either or both of these players.
Ardmore Avenue just behind there, the road that runs along the entrance to the club there. And this was a reaction by Dougherty after he got that one in the previous hole.
Well, the greens here at Merion will make you sigh of relief when you make those short putts. They are very difficult, very speedy, and as we've touched on, quite a bit of slope.
Molinari is believed to be the first Italian to compete in this championship. Now, there very well could have been some guy that squeaked there into the annals back in the early going to this championship, but I believe Molinari thinks he is.
Well, you have to really tip your hat to him. Come all the way from Italy just to try to qualify, to go through the 36-hole qualifying, to have a chance to play in this championship. And he did it quite well. Played at Hayfields Country Club down in just outside of Baltimore. Shot 139 and led that qualifying.
Might take a little more research to confirm that, but
smooth looking swing there.
Over that huge bunker safely.
Good result.
Well, we do know this for sure. There's a look at the foreign born U.S. amateur champions. Only 10 of the 104 champions have been foreign born players, and just one in the last 34 years, as you look at Nick Flanagan out of Australia a couple of years ago at Oakmont.
So Dillon Dougherty now kind of looking upward, Roger, I assume, trying to figure out if there's any wind.
Yes, trees to the right of the tee here. Starting to move, making a little noise, wrestling in the wind. So checking out, certainly a little bit of an opening for him here, I think.
Well, certainly with a pitching wedge in hand, soft green, this is a chance to make a good swing and get the ball certainly within birdie range. Well, that's not a good shot, and that's the only way to describe that. That's a good 40 feet from the hole. You can tell he is not pleased.
Dillon Dougherty in a 3-down hole to Edoardo Molinari.
It's the final of the U.S. Amateur Championship, and it features Italy's Edoardo Molinari against Dillon Dougherty of the United States. And as it stands, it looks like it could be Molinari who's on his way to getting his name engraved on this trophy and joining a great set of past champions. So the likes of Jack Nicklaus, of Tiger Woods, Phil Mickelson, Arnold Palmer, all with their names on this trophy. The latest incumbent, Ryan Moore, last year. What a player he looks like. Nick Flanagan of Australia broke the run of American winners. Ricky Barnes, who I think a lot of people expected a lot more of him after he won the US Amateur. Hasn't quite done it yet in the professional game, has he, Brian?
No, that's right. He had a very good Masters, and everybody thought, my God, this fellow is going to be the guy of the future. But it hasn't happened, and I think it's like a lot of things, though, really, Dom. It takes some guys a little bit longer to gain their confidence, to get used to the tour, especially the different golf courses that are being played. I think we've already mentioned that most of the older fellas have played these golf courses many times, so they know every intricacy that mm-hmm. there is on the golf course. But it's taking... what was the guy's name? Ricky Barnes.
Yes.
A little bit longer to get things going, but I think that he has proved he has the ability, and maybe he's just a little too impatient.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, a lot of obviously successful players have come via this route: Marco Mira, Hal Sutton, Scott LeBlanc, Mickelson, there, John Cook. Stadler, Craig Stadler, Watkins. I mean, most of them are there stage.
Right, sure.
They've taken on this championship. Tiger, of course, won it three times on the spin, 94, 95 and 96, and we all know what it meant to him. So it is a big, big prize, and one that anyone who wins it would certainly treasure. So back to the action then in Merion with NBC Television.
And another one of the 17 USGA championships held here. The popular Lee Trevino got things shook up a little bit on the first tee of the playoff with Jack Nicklaus throwing out the rubber snake. I guess if anybody can get into the head of the Golden Bear, it's the Mary Max.
He had a great record against Nicklaus head-to-head.
He fired a 68 in that playoff round of Nicklaus's 71. He later went on to win the British Open and the Canadian Open. This was the second Open title for Lee Trevino, following up that 68 victory at Oak Hill. Had a great deal of respect for Jack, but as you said, Gary, he got the better of him at Merion back in 1971. To just add to the Merion history here. And who will be the latest to make their own history here? Right now, it looks like the Italian Molinari through 30 with six holes left. And they're at the par 3 13th here, and Roger Maltby's out there.
Al Dillon Dougherty will be first to putt, and again, has to be disappointed, Dan, with that tee shot. That was just not a particularly good effort. Pitching wedge in hand, ball on a tee, hit it 35, 40 feet right of the hole. Molinari has seemed to be very calm throughout this championship, even when he was down earlier.
Well, he had a little positive mojo. Dougherty did in the quarterfinals against Ryan Yip on this hole. Yip had hit it pretty stiff there, and what did Dougherty do? Came out of the thick rough, and look at his dad in the background.
Yeah.
Fired up.
And Yip would go on to miss the putt for birdie. And Dougherty's way to winning.
Yeah,
that
he won
match.
The hole to go two up there and ended up winning by a final count of 4-2.
Well, he needs some magic like that right now. Three down to Molinari at this point with some very difficult holes coming up, starting at 14. And Molinari certainly striking the ball well, putting the ball beautifully. Sir, doesn't appear to be any signs of any weakness. So I think it's going to be Dougherty who's going to have to make something happen.
It's time to tug that Northwestern baseball cap down a little bit lower, like a reliever who comes into the ninth inning, and get it done.
All right, putt that's tough to read, moves more to the right than it looks.
How about now? It?
Oh, man, what a good putt. Mm.
So close. We thought he had it. So did he for a moment.
Well, now all he can do is sit back and watch, and he's watched Molinari for a number of putts of this length in this afternoon round. You know, you have to wonder if some of Molinari's confidence hasn't come from last year. He played in the World Amateur Team event representing Italy and led Italy to their best finish ever in that event, fourth place finish. It was a World Amateur that was held here back in 1960 that Jack Nicklaus shot a score of 269, a record score that has held up for 45 years in that event.
Yeah, how good is that? His brother was on that team, too.
Yeah.
World Amateur Team. He's by himself here at Merion this week and faring very, very well. A habit 13 keeps Molinari's lead 3 up.
The U.S. Amateur Championship continues with Edoardo Molinari of Italy, still 3 up against Dillon Dougherty. If you are just coming in, you may not know that Brad Faxon has won the Buick Championship. It went to a playoff. Only lasted one hole. Faxon winning for the 8th time on the PGA Tour and beating Tjaart van der Walde of South Africa. Both finished at 14 under par through the regulation 72 holes. Justin Rose finishing just one off the pace, 13 under par after closing with a round of 69. Confirmation of that victory for Faxon. Deserved it, really, with his final round of 61. 64 for Tjaart van der Walde. As I said, a 69 for Justin Rose. Finishes third on his own, so it's a good week. Michael Putnam, a young man who's only turned professional this week. A great finish from him, a round of 63. Tied fourth with Jerry Kelly and Ben Curtis. Kenny Perry finishing strongly, so too Corey Pavin. Woody Austin, the defending champion, and Nick Watney completing the top 10. Meanwhile, a little bit earlier in Munich, it was a second European Tour victory for David Howe. Long time between victories, of course, David winning in 1999. He's had a terrific season. He's lost out in a couple of playoffs this year, had a rib injury, has come back from that, and it was a final round of 65 in the end, pipping John Daly by just a single stroke. Daly missed out on making birdie at the closing hole, missed a 6-foot putt there. So David Howe with a par at the 18th, winning that title. Brett Rumford finishing in a tie for second with Daly. Nicholas Fast and Soren Kjeldsen up there. Paul McGinley continues his good form. Bradley Dredge having a very steady season. Simon Dyson and Simon Kahn also up there. Luke Donald, of course, took a one-shot lead into the final round. Bit of a struggle for Luke, I'm afraid. A 73 will be slightly disappointing for him. Harrington finished with a 67. Thomas Bjorn, who's won this title a couple of times, a 70. Miguel Angel Jimenez was the defending champion, of course. And Ian Poulter, 72 in the final round for Ian, just inside the top 40. So that's what happened both at the Buick Championship and on the European Tour at the BMW International. Right now, of course, we're concentrating on what's happening in the championship match, as they call it. It's the final of the US Amateur, and it's back to the action now at Merion with NBC.
One of Bobby Jones's early rivals was Chick Evans, who won the 1916 US Open, and then more than a couple of months later, in the very first US Amateur held here at Merion, became the first player to win two USGA titles in the same year. Get you back out to the action here. Let's set up the 14th.
Well, 438-yard par four, and the players actually play from an area off the putting green on this dogleg left uphill par four. Fairway's been moved over to the right to bring these fairway bunkers into play. Ideal tee shot in this range here, just short of that last fairway bunker on the right. Second shot is played uphill. Players can't see all of the putting surface. Hole today is located over in the middle right portion of the green. Certainly don't want to go long. This is a good birdie opportunity if you can put the ball in play off the tee.
And here is Molinari with that 3-up lead right now.
And ideally, you'd like to take this ball up the right side of the fairway, kind of at that middle fairway bunker you see there. Turn it a little bit right to left. Follow the flow of the hole. That is a shot that Molinari likes to hit.
Thanks.
And apparently has done just that. Always a good sign when you pick the tee up quickly.
Well, next Saturday at 4:30 Eastern, 1:30 Pacific, it's the AVP Nissan Series coming back to NBC for the Chicago Open, presented by McDonald's. You'll see the Golden Girls of Athens, Misty May and Kerry Walsh there. Coverage begins next Saturday, 4:30 Eastern, 1:30 Pacific, right here on NBC. Now it's Dougherty's turn in that three-down position.
And Dillon Dougherty has a little harder time working the ball right to left, especially off the tee, so I would expect him to aim more left, which he's doing. And try to play the ball up the left-hand side, maybe let it leak a little to the right.
Great job, Dillon.
Yeah, he's done that nicely, and that should stay in the right side of the fairway.
Well, the championship history here at Merion is really unrivaled. And with a look at the man who made unprecedented history here three quarters of a century ago is Jimmy Roberts.
In the last few years, Tiger Woods has flirted with winning the four most important championships of the day, the U.S. and British Opens, the Masters, and the PGA. And so we occasionally find ourselves discussing golf's Grand Slam. But the fact of the matter is, in more than a century of play, only one man has accomplished the feat. Bobby Jones, 75 years ago, he finished it off right here at Merion, winning the four most important events of his time. It was 5 years before the Masters even existed. Back in a time when amateur golf was a bigger deal than the professional game, and Jones was as big a deal as anybody. But for as historic as his accomplishments were during that magic summer of 1930, the Grand Slam came close to fizzling before it even started. Of the eight matches in the first leg that year, the British amateur, Jones won three by the slimmest possible margin, just one up. From St. Andrews, it was on to Hoylake, where he claimed his third British Open title in 5 years. He was halfway to someplace no one had ever been before, and America took notice. The United States in 1930 was reeling from the Depression and desperate for something to feel good about. Jones was just that something. He was dominant and modest and had absolutely no interest in playing golf for money. He returned from England to a ticker tape parade. A week later at Interlaken, he became the first man to ever break par for 72 holes at the US Open. It was his fourth Open title, tying the all-time record. Still, it was just an ascending note in the crescendo. At Merion, Jones would have a chance to make history if he could win the amateur, and interest was rabid. The Philadelphia Evening Bulletin assigned 16 writers and photographers. Marines had to be brought in to control the crowds. For the sixth time in his life, Jones was the medalist. In match play, not a single one of his contests went past the 14th hole. In the final, he won 8 and 7. And then, after doing the seemingly impossible, at age 28, he laid down his clubs and never played another competitive round again. And if you think about it, why not quit here? After all, Merion was the place where Jones played in his first ever major championship, the 1916 U.S. Amateur. This was the place where he won his first ever amateur in 1924. Now it was where he would win golf's one and only Grand Slam. Not only that, but do something else which has proved so elusive to so many sportsmen over so much time. He went out on top.
Yes, he did. And as you can see, the players to win the same USGA event on the same course twice. It was the first and last U.S. Amateur Championship won by Bobby Jones, which Jimmy described back in 1930. Both right here at Merion. Jack pulling off the same duo there at Baltusrol. Bobby Jones first played here as a teenager. This guy looked like a teenager when he won the 1975 U.S. Amateur Championship. Mr. Fred Ridley hoisting that Havemeyer Trophy, and now the president of the United States Golf Association, kind enough to join us in our booth here. And I know that you've still got 5 months left to go in the presidency here, but this is our last NBC event, our last event with you guys on NBC for this summer. So thought we'd have you come up and ask you a couple of questions. And as you reflect on what has happened in this tenure as recently, what do you think are you most proud of as you look back in your tenure as president of the USGA so far?
Well, Dan, I think it's been a fantastic 2 years, certainly. We've refocused a bit on championships. After all, that's what drives the engine of the USGA. It makes all the things we do possible, whether it's our grants program, our turf grass research, whatever we do, it's all about the championships. But I think the other thing that I'm the most pleased with is that we've had an opportunity over these 2 years really to reach out to others, to other organizations. I think the organizations involved in golf are working better together than they have ever before. So I think those are a couple of things that I'm pleased about that we've been able to do.
And maybe something that you've learned that as you look back, you can maybe tell the next president or the organization as you leave, hey, let's try this. Maybe we could do this a little better.
Well, that's right. And we certainly have great leadership in place over the next 2 years. Walter Driver will be succeeding me as president. And Walter and the rest of the executive committee, working with David Fay, who heads up our staff of over 300 people at Golf House. It's going to be a great team for the coming year. So I feel really good about where things are as I'm leaving the USGA in the beginning of next year.
Well, Fred, it's been a great championship here at Merion. Merion's done a lot of work through the years to try to get the course ready for this event. And there's obviously a lot of talk about could another U.S. Open be coming to Merion. Your thoughts on that?
Well, we do have a little bit more of the U.S. Amateur to go, Gary, and it's been a really exciting one. I think that to have these great amateurs be able to walk the same fairways that Bobby Jones and Ben Hogan did when he won in 1950, and then, of course, Trevino and Nicklaus in 71, it's really been a special treat. But, we're certainly considering Merion among a lot of other courses. We'll get back, debrief after this one. Our staff will have a lot of input, and we'll be talking about it over the fall and in October when we meet. But certainly, there's a lot to talk about, and Merion should be very proud of the way that they've conducted the U.S. Amateur here. It's been a great amateur.
All right, Fred, thanks for joining us. We know we can look forward to the 2009 Walker Cup, which is headed here to the East Course at Merion. Thanks a lot for coming up, we'll see you down the road.
Okay, thanks a lot.
All right, back out to the action here. Dougherty's second.
It's from 166.
Fly.
That's a good looking shot.
Keep going.
Oh, yeah. Over the stick at 14. Good time to make a move. And when Fred Ridley makes his move out of the presidency seat of the USGA, there's the man, Walter Driver. Driver, who will ascend to that position. Chairman of the championship committee presently. And out on the golf course here at Merion watching the action. So pretty good shot there, Roger, by Dougherty.
A very, very good shot.
As we look at the scorecard of Molinari, the opening birdies, and then at 7 and 9 out in 4 under 32.
Coming back with birdies at 10 and 11, 6 under par for 13 holes. That really some good golf. Second shot now from 153.
This ball turning left of the hole, turning at the left side of the green.
Well, that's going to leave an interesting putt down through that little low that runs through the center of the putting surface.
Crowd rushes in to get a close look. Dougherty close in there at the 14th, looking to cut into the Edoardo Molinari lead in the championship match. Welcome back to this 105th U.S. Amateur Championship staged at Merion Golf Club just outside Philadelphia. Edoardo Molinari with a 3-up lead through 31 of the 36-hole championship match over Dillon Dougherty. But Dougherty with the advantage here just over the hole with a short birdie putt.
And a very difficult birdie putt for Edoardo Molinari. You can see a dark patch in the green. Well, there's a low right through here. So his ball will have to come off this high, down through the low, and then back up as it gets toward the hole. So this putt is going to be extremely difficult to judge the pace and the break as well. Roger, at this point, I would think Molinari would be very happy to just get this up close to the hole and force Dougherty to have to make his ball close, but still some 4 or 5 feet away, right?
Certainly, I agree with you, Gary. There's no guarantee that Dougherty's putt is no gimme, let's put it that way. So important to hit this ball with the right speed.
All right, there's the down. Here's the back up.
Pretty good effort there.
Very well done.
He's just been incredible with the putter this afternoon.
Well, we've seen Dylan and his dad, Dan, really grind over this line here. And earlier, Jimmy Roberts talked to Dylan about his dad's caddying skills.
This week it's been really good. I've been pretty calm and I haven't really got upset at all. And that would be the only time, you know, if I get upset, I may, you know, give him a little grief. But everything's been good. He's not that great of a caddy.
Really?
But
what does he do wrong?
He miscalculates yardages. But you know, in terms of being here with me and keeping me, you know, in the moment and level-headed, everything's been great, and we've had a great time.
So some candidness by Dylan.
Well,
there.
You have to admire that. He also has talked about the fact that his dad tends to agree on just about everything that he says on the greens, and probably pretty smart on dad's part, just trying to boost the confidence.
Well, again, it was Dylan who said, "You're going to be with me at the amateur." He's given his dad a real boost in a time where he really needed it. And talk about needing a putt.
Got to stay up.
Dougherty four, Mr. Molinari four, Mr. Molinari remains three up.
Well, Dad has had a hard time composing himself here this week with all the emotion that's been going through his body. He, when Dylan chipped in at 17 yesterday in that semifinal, he came roaring down that hill, took his hat off and threw it on the green, and then later apologized to the caddy of J.C. Deacon, his opponent. Well, coming tomorrow on USA, it's tennis's final slam of the year, the 2005 U.S. Open, and USA Network will be there live from Flushing Meadows for 11 consecutive days and nights of action starring all of tennis's best. Sharapova, Roddick, Federer, the Williams sisters all there. Don't miss it. 11 a.m. on USA Network tomorrow. Well, the 15th, Gary.
And a beautiful dogleg right par four, 411 yards, and the tee shot is really the critical shot. You want to try to go right over that bunker right there. You certainly do not want to go to the left. You'll see about 300 yards there. The X is over there because the out-of-bounds is only some 15 feet left of the fairway. Uphill second shot, green very severely sloping back to front, right to left, and you do not want to hit it in this front right bunker. It is about 6 to 8 feet deep, and you can see today's hole location right over that very deep bunker.
Well, it's getting crunch time here. If Molinari can win this hole, he can close it out right here.
Well, it's been 15 holes now that Dylan Dougherty has gone without winning a hole, so momentum clearly the side of Molinari.
Tee shot drawing down the left side, left center, should be good.
Yeah, the soft fairway has made this hole a little bit easier off the tee. Roger, earlier in the week, we saw some balls scamper through the fairway toward the out of bounds, but certainly not the case now with the rain this morning. Has softened up.
Well, win or lose, the Doughertys say they're going to head to Kildare's Irish Pub. We talked with Uncle Neil today, Dylan's uncle, Dan's brother, and he said that that's where Dad and son have been going all week. And as the Doughertys have joined in here one by one, he said, win or lose, we're heading back there. It's been such a great week, positive experience.
Stick to your routine here. He usually makes two practice swings. There we go. Picture the shot. Trust it. Let it go.
This should be good too, down the left center of the fairway.
Just behind Molinari's ball and trailing. Three down with four to play. Molinari with a Havemeyer Trophy in his sights.
Winning the U.S. Amateur, I think, allowed me to believe in myself at the very highest level in amateur golf. Prior to winning that, there was always that question in my mind, is how I stood against the other amateur players and was I prepared for professional golf, and I think having won the amateur set the stage for that confidence in my mind.
Back in 1980, Hal Sutton at the Country Club of North Carolina beating Bob Lewis, the recent Walker Cup captain for the United States at Chicago Golf Club. Sutton beat Lewis back in 1989 and 8. Well, this is not only our final telecast of the year of a USGA event, but it marks the end of an era within the governing body of golf. If you're even a casual golf fan, you probably recognize the name or face of that man, Tom Meeks. For 30 years, a loyal and devoted employee of the USGA, for the past decade, the association's senior director of rules and competitions. In simpler terms, he's the guy with the last word and huge responsibility of setting up the course for all these national championships they conduct, including the U.S. Open. Yes, he has taken some heat, but he will be the first to admit that it comes with the territory. Through it all, his professionalism and passion for the game were exemplary, and all of us at NBC Sports are going to miss him. After this, his 179th USGA event, and Gary, when I asked him what his first event was, he didn't hesitate. He said, in that twang of his, Girls Junior, 1976, score 3-2.
Did he know the winner?
Well, I didn't push him that far.
Oh, okay.
But that's Tom Meeks right there, remembering the entire ride.
Yeah, well, he has done a tremendous job for the USGA, has represented that organization extremely well for quite some period of time. And you're correct. I think he will be missed by everyone who is involved in the game of golf.
Indeed. Well, in the earlier 18, pretty nice pair of shots here, Gary, coming up to this 15th. Doherty had the two-up lead in the morning when they came here.
He played this second shot perfectly. Green's being softer. There's a big slope, some 8 or 10 yards behind the hole. Throw it back into that slope. Let gravity take over. At this point, it looked like it might go in. That would lead to a conceded birdie.
And then Molinari from the rough.
Well, much more difficult shot. Hard to judge just how quickly the ball will come out of this long, wet rough, and he guessed just right. So the hole would be halved with threes.
And Doherty could use a three right now.
Well, he's left himself 145 yards to the hole. And really, this is the kind of hole, I guess, Gary, you got to take it in a little long and a little behind the hole on the left to get it to come back in the area of the cup.
Well, I would think he's got to have a good picture here, Roger. We just showed the shot he hit this morning, and that's exactly how he played it. So I know as a player, certainly when I played, anytime you came to a hole where you'd played a good shot before, it seemed to just make a difference, make it easier. Well, it's quite a bit uphill on the second shot, only some 7 or 8 yards, longer than the yardage.
He's like a batter in a the on-deck circle, with the way he works that towel. I wonder he doesn't have some pine tar out there.
Well, I'll give him credit. You know, this is a tough situation to be in, but he is sticking to his routine, and that shows me that he's got his mind in the right place.
Well, that's a good-looking shot here.
Just underneath the hole. Certainly a makeable birdie putt.
Okay, Molinari with the response here.
135 left of the hole.
I was saying earlier when we did a replay of a swing that the downswing motion resembles a little bit that of Sergio Garcia. Well, Molinari was saying that he's played some golf with Sergio Garcia as a junior a few years back. In Europe, knows him quite well.
Well, one thing for sure, Gary, is you can see how Molinari has grown during the day. I mean, much more confident player than he looked this morning. He is really, really looking confident at the moment.
Well, he just looks dialed in, doesn't he, Roger? I mean, you can just tell the movements are easy, calm.
Oh, that's a good looking shot too.
Well, It'll spin back just outside of Dougherty's ball. Still well played.
Okay, so Dougherty inside of him there at the 15th. Three up with four to play. Closing in on the most prestigious title in amateur golf.
Winning the amateur opened the door for me. It made it all possible, and it was, as far as I'm concerned, the most important single golf tournament that I ever won. It pumped me up personally. It gave me confidence that I needed to get on with my life.
Arnold, just 24 years old back in 1954, when he beat Robert Sweeney one up in the final at that Country Club of Detroit.
And a very common thread there, too, listening to what Arnold had to say. We heard it from Hal Sutton. We heard it from Mickelson. We heard it even from Tiger Woods, that it gave them the impetus to know that they could move on and play professional golf successfully. So just shows you a little bit about how important this event is.
And the last time a champion won at the age of 24, Arnold Palmer back in 1954, and that's the exact age of Edoardo Molinari, who can win this hole and win the amateur championship right here. And Paolo has never been too far away. He had a bucket hat on yesterday in the overcast skies today at Merion. He's opted to go without it.
They came over early in the week and actually played some golf here in the Philadelphia area, but they played on some municipal courses. I guess they found them on the internet and went out and played, didn't really have anywhere to play, so that's how they figured out what courses to go see. And I guess some of the guys that they played with at some of those municipal courses have been out in the gallery following him this week. So,
well, there's just nine golf courses total in the Torino area, which has a population of more than 2 million. And the Molinaris learned their golf at the Torino Golf Club, as we mentioned earlier. And Molinari was telling me the other night that, you know, brothers have a tendency to push each other. Mm-hmm. And his brother, obviously a good golfer, a little younger than he is, and all introduced to the game by their dad. They pushed each other pretty well.
Well, Molinari was saying also that he has sent an entry into the European Tour qualifying school for this fall. But now, after earning a berth in both the U.S. Open and the Masters, and able to play, he has to remain an amateur. So
those will be canceled.
Yep, I would imagine the qualifying school will wait. Roger, makeable putt here up the hill.
It certainly is. Not a lot of break in this putt that I see.
Another one for Molinari. Bene, says Dad. Seventh birdie of the afternoon, and it might just be the one that puts it away. Dougherty has to make his to have the hole and extend the match.
Well, there's one thing that if Dillon Dougherty goes on to lose this match, he can know that it was won by the other guy. I mean, it's not like Dillon Dougherty has given this away this afternoon. He's played some pretty solid golf. It's just Molinari's unbelievable.
Yeah, he really hasn't been out of the holes big time and posted any doubles. Just got the one bogey, got the one birdie that came at the 11th, but Molinari made one on him there as well to keep his two up lead. It's just been too much Molinari and too many birdies for Dougherty to contend with. But it's not over yet. Chance here for Dougherty to move it to the next hole. Roger.
Well, this one will move a little bit to his right. And what can you say? You know, he's played some pretty good golf, going out with a three-up lead after this morning, and just got run over by a freight train, it seems.
Is the 105th U.S. Amateur Champion, 4-3. becomes the first player from continental Europe to win a men's USGA championship. And just the second Italian to win a USGA title, joining Silvia Cavallari, the 97 women's amateur champ in that category. And the sentimental journey of the Doughertys comes to a close. Multi-bene for Edoardo Molinari. What a performance. Four and three, the biggest winning margin in the final since 99 when David Gossett beat Sung-Yoon Kim of South Korea 9-8. Getting a hug from Trevor Harvey, Molinari's caddy there. Well, why wouldn't a birdie close it out for Molinari? Seventh on the day.
And it never looked like it was going anywhere but right in the bottom of the hole.
Dillon Dougherty ran into a buzzsaw in Molinari today. Paolo watches it go down. And with it, his son's name will be etched on the Havemeyer Trophy. And this great sportsmanship just continued even to the very end. You got to hand it to Molinari. Dougherty had the best seat in the house all day watching it. And we'll be back to hear from both Dougherty and Molinari when we come back. 4-3, Edoardo wins it.
What a victory it was. What an impressive performance. Brian Barnes alongside me, the standard of golf there, Brian. Something different.
Unbelievable. It really was. Both kids played superbly well. And all the way to the end. And it was played in wonderful spirit. Mm-hmm. And I congratulate them both. I think that Eduardo is something to look forward to in the future on the European Tour. But, of course, he's had sense enough to realize that if he wants to play in the Masters and the US Open, and, of course, the British Open, he's going to stay amateur for another year. So, and who knows? He might even go back and defend the title for the US amateur and win it again. He's good enough. There's no doubt about that.
It'll be tempting, though, won't it, for him to turn professional?
Well, yeah, but I think he's... I think he's made up his mind that he wants to play the Masters. Mm-hmm. And the sooner he manages to play that, the better. Now, whether he continues on after that and plays the British Open and the US Open, I would think it probably depends on how well he does in the Masters.
We shall see. He is our champion. Let's get back to NBC.
What a turnaround by Edoardo Molinari. Three down going into the afternoon 18. In the morning, he won just three holes, while Dougherty won six. In the afternoon, he won seven, while Dougherty, Gary, didn't win a single hole.
Well, it's hard to win when your opponent's making seven birdies, so certainly understandable.
And the man that was on the short end of all those Molinari birdies, the Doughertys with Roger.
Thank you, Dan. Dillon, condolences, but you certainly have to feel like Eduardo won this amateur championship. You certainly didn't lose it, don't you believe?
Yeah, Eduardo was phenomenal. I don't know what he shot exactly, but I think it was maybe 7 under that in those 15 holes. And out here, that it's hard to beat. Played pretty solid and just got killed this afternoon. So it was all Eduardo, and congratulations to him.
Well, Dad, this has been a pretty special week for you, hasn't it, watching your son play this caliber golf and having a chance to win the National Amateur?
Yes, it has. It's been absolutely perfect. Whether, you know, regardless of today or not, I mean, it was perfect.
And with it go a few goodies that came yesterday with your play. So not all is lost this week, don't you think?
Oh, not at all. It was all positive. I can't wait for Augusta and the Open. And it was just a great week.
Now, destiny seemed to play such a part in your championship efforts this week. If you could talk to your grandpa now, what do you think he'd say?
I think he'd just say he's said great playing. Make a few more putts today, and I'm proud of you.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
I think it was
much.
A great week for you. Back to you, Dan.
Thank you, Roger. Players to win in their first attempt. Molinari joins this list. Flanagan a couple of years ago, and on down through the men. And we'll have the presentation to the 2005 champion from Italy. First one ever from Italy to put his name on this Havemeyer Trophy. Back to Merion on Championship Sunday in a moment.
So I wonder Brian Barnes, young Dillon Dougherty is going to employ his father when he plays at the Masters after what he said earlier on about him.
I don't know.
Maybe not.
I have a sneaky suspicion that Dad might decide that he doesn't really want to caddy there. That's really the big time.
Fall on his sword.
Yeah, that's right. But, he's a lovely young man, and he said everything right there. And unfortunately, I think the last question he was asked was rather tactless and completely unnecessary.
About his grandfather.
About his grandfather, yeah. Yeah, you know, he's in a difficult position and probably feels, that he's slightly hard done by, that he came up against somebody playing so superbly well this afternoon.
A bit like swimming against the tide.
Well, that's exactly right.
Right, let's get back to NBC, shall we?
As they gather for the presentation to the champion Edoardo Molinari up there on the 15th green, a chance to show you kind of what happened today. And it really was the tale, Gary, of two 18s in the morning rain. This was at the third, a par miss for Molinari. Not really making some bad strokes, but just not able to get it down.
Well, that's exactly what happened to him in the morning 18. We see another good stroke. The ball doesn't go in the hole. And importantly, by knowing he's hitting good putts, I think it allowed him to remain patient and therefore keep doing the same thing.
Three down after the morning 18, and in the movie Rocky Balboa had some raw eggs. He just started drinking out of glasses and somehow turned it around. It seemed like Molinari was a new man, an Italian stallion in the afternoon. Well, this was the first hole.
Uses a sand wedge, blades the ball right into the hole from the fringe.
And then at the second, makes it a birdie start, and this was the sign of things to come. Turns that three-down deficit into a one-down deficit at that point. And then here at the long par four fifth, this was his third after both players had some problems.
Well, he plays a beautiful short iron here, utilizes the slope and the green, spins the ball back down below the hole, importantly, and he was able to make that putt and win yet another hole.
And square the match. And then here at the seventh hole, another birdie, and this would give Molinari his very first lead of the entire day. And then at the ninth for a birdie again.
Now this one downhill, turning to the left, not an easy putt, and look where it goes.
So that gave him a two-up lead. So four birdies out in 32. And then here at the 11th.
Another one from long range, and another one that just seeks the cup and goes right in.
Right about there where Dougherty was thinking, what do I have to do to beat this guy? And then here at the 15th, both had birdie putts, but Molinari closed it out with his seventh birdie of the day. And Dad Paolo had a great seat there. 4-3 win for Edoardo Molinari. And with it comes a lot of good stuff. Exemption in next year's U.S. Open, invitation to play in next year's Masters, and a spot in the British Open as well. As you see there at Royal Liverpool, an exemption to the next 10 U.S. Amateur Championships as well. And right now we're getting set for the presentation over at the 15th.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Fred, President of the United States Golf Association. And welcome to the prize presentation ceremony for the 2005 United States Amateur. Please join me in welcoming Edoardo Molinari, the 105th United States Amateur Champion.
Can you tell us what was the difference between the Edoardo Molinari of this morning and the Edoardo Molinari of this afternoon?
I don't really know. I was very calm today, both this morning and this afternoon. And then this afternoon I got off to a good start and then just keep it going from then on. And the putt was really, really hot today.
Now, you will collect the Havermeyer Trophy. Have you seen some of the names on this trophy that your name will now be linked with forever?
Yeah, I'm very, very pleased and proud of it. It looks good.
Well, you came over here and qualified, then went back home, and we believe really the first Italian to certainly play in the amateur, compete for the amateur. Is there going to be a pretty good party back in Torino when you get home?
Yeah, I think so. A very, very big party. I'm sure about it.
How about tonight? These people want to know where to go.
I just have rest tonight. I think tomorrow I'm gonna caddy for my father out here. So let's see what happens tomorrow.
Well, congratulations on being the 105th U.S. Amateur Champion. Danny, back to you.
Thank you, Roger. And Gary, in a country where really soccer and skiing are the most popular sports, the most indelible image that we can remember of an Italian golfer is Costantino Rocco, right? Hands on the ground, pounding after making that putt through the valley of the sand of the 95 British Open, eventually got into a playoff loss to John Daly. But I would have to say, after what he did today here, handling this course and the manner in which he handled it, you know Edoardo Molinari's name is going to come up a few times over there as well.
Well, I would certainly think so. I mean, a remarkable accomplishment when you think about it, to really make the commitment to come all the way from Italy just to try to qualify. One day, 36 holes, have to play well, very few spots available to make it. Come back over, play in this championship, barely get into the match play portion. Birdied his final hole to get into a playoff.
Bunker shot.
Exactly. It just is a remarkable story and a remarkable play by him today. I'm sure he's one who's very glad that the final was 36 holes because it gave him the opportunity to come back and make some of those putts that he wasn't making in the morning, even though he was putting very well.
And it continues an international trend in these championships conducted by the USGA. Remember, Piners number two, Michael Campbell from New Zealand won there, becoming just the second Kiwi to win a major championship, joining Bob Charles, who won the 1963 British Open. And then not too far after that, who could forget, on the 72nd hole, Birdie Kim from South Korea
makes a very unlikely birdie
to win the biggest championship in women's golf and overcome the young amateur out there, Morgan Pressel. So five of the nine USGA national championships so far this year have been won by foreign-born players and future sights. What a lineup, Gary, as we head to Hazeltine next year. And
well, just some wonderful golf courses. And, hey, Dan, it's good to be an amateur.
And well done to Edoardo Molinari. It's been a good golfing year for Italy, hasn't it, with Emmanuel Canonico, Brian Barnes almost thinking about giving up golf and then winning on the European Tour. And it's been a while since Costantino Rocco was at his best, so it would be nice to see the Italians as a strong golfing nation again.
Yeah, it would, and it's surprising. You know, let's face it, it wasn't that long ago that Katy Perry was thinking about giving up golf as well. And I think that probably gave him the opportunity of really starting to play well again, because he was thinking of giving it up, he relaxed. Mm-hmm. And allowed his swing to take over once again, and mm-hmm. this is exactly what happened, I think. You know, it's wonderful to see Italy produce some golfers, because they've been very much in the doldrums for many, many years, and to see some great Italian golfers come through.
And they've got some nice courses down there as well, haven't they?
Wonderful, and I think this is part and parcel of it. It's always been a very much of a secondary sport in Italy. You know, it's an expensive sport, mm-hmm. But they've, I think, managed to produce a few more public golf courses, which gives more people an opportunity of being able to play. And, of course, the more people that play, the more chance they've got of being able to produce some good players. And, of course, having people like Seve coming through from Spain and Garcia and Olazabal makes a big, big difference.
It certainly does. So we will follow the progress, obviously, of Italian golf on Sky Sports, as we do every week. And we have for you coming up this week another busy lineup of golf, World of Golf this week. is Wednesday, 5 o'clock, Sky Sports Extra. And then again at 7 o'clock on Sky Sports 3. If you'd like to get in contact with the programme, don't forget it's worldofgolf@skysports.com on the email, and our experts will do their best to answer your queries. Double bill once again for you this week on Sky Sports, starting with the European Tour. It's the Omega European Masters up in the mountains in Switzerland. Always a terrific event. It's the start of the qualifying system for the next year's European Ryder Cup team as well. So an exciting edge there. Thursday, 10:30 with the morning starters, 3:30 for those going off in the afternoon. Sky Sports 1. Luke Donald defends there. And the Deutsche Bank gets underway Friday from 10 o'clock in the evening. Sky Sports 2. A wonderful field there. Vijay Singh defending, Tiger Woods in the field, and many others as well. So that about wraps it up from us. Thanks very much to Brian Barnes for being with us this week. Enjoyed your company, Brian. I know you've enjoyed the golf.
Thanks, Tom.
We've seen some good stuff, not just from Edoardo Molinari of Italy creating history, but Brad Faxon as well. From us all here for now, it's goodbye.